The price is wrong, bitch.
I think you've had enough. No? Now you've had enough, bitch.
Hey, and welcome again, everybody, to another episode of What the Hell Happened to Them? Adam Sandler Saga. What movie are we doing today?
Happy Gilmore.
Happy Gilmore.
Remix.
Hey everybody, welcome back to What the Hell Happened to Them. You thought you liked it the first time, but we're coming back to Adam Sandler and cleaning up some of our old mistakes. I am your host, Patrick Skeyhill. Joining me on the line is a Subway enthusiast, Joe Vekeman. I don't know why I paused there.
Okay, I didn't know if you heard my stomach, like,
yeah,
saying,
yeah, it's ruining everything. And the man who secured the Subway product placement, Lev Van Rensselaer, the audio maven that we are craving, producing all the sounds that make us so slippery and smooth. All right, Joe, what movie are we remixing this week?
1996's Happy Gilmore!
That's right. Certainly a Sandler staple for any fans, and even just people who know Sandler must know he does Happy Gilmore. It's in his production company's name. What happens in this movie, Joe?
What happens in Happy Gilmore? Now, as someone who did his homework, when I initially was requested to give the plot synopsis,
yes,
I failed miserably. And in fact, you kind of cut me down pretty hard.
It just took you forever.
Well, that's before I found out a trick. Don't think about it. Just read.
Just live.
And let me read to you. A rejected hockey player puts his skills to the golf course to save his grandmother's house. Boom. That's exactly what you said the last time.
It's very close. I don't know. I don't remember the word
it's
rejected, almost, but I got the gist.
Almost verbatim what you said.
Yeah, log lines are stupid easy in this business, Joe.
They just
fucking all do the same crap.
I'm figuring it out slowly. Yes.
All right, Joe. Well, you have purportedly watched this 8 times since we recorded this compared to my this time. How has this movie changed for you in the last 8 years?
It's just gone better.
Yeah.
It just gets better and better every time I watch it.
Of course, right? This and Bailey Madison were your childhood films.
Absolutely. Along with Big Daddy. I would say for a short pocket, Big Daddy was way above Billy Madison and Happy Gilmore.
Oh, wow.
But then it took its rightful place as 5th or 6th.
Yeah. I gotcha.
Yeah, this movie is incredible. I was going to come in here and I was just going to start picking apart every little thing and saying, hey, are you looking at it? Like, I was going to do like a room like 234. Is that the hotel room in The Shining? Like, I was going to kind of do like, hey.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was going to be like, the numbers on the scoreboard keep equaling 23, which is the number on Happy Gilmore's hockey jersey. And I was like, the number 23 is everywhere. And then I was like, wait, I feel like this is a Jim Carrey movie. And yeah. I was grateful to stop. But no, I really noticed there was a couple of things that I wanted to point out that we really didn't talk about last time. Mainly the source of Sandler's anger in this movie. I am coming to the conclusion that when his mother walks out on him and his father at the beginning of the movie, as she leaves for Egypt, where he says, there's not a hockey rink in sight, which is a good joke.
Yeah, probably
and,
true.
And I'm like, already, mother abandonment issues. Of course he's going to be upset. He's okay. A child without a mother now. And then shortly after, when his father, who is kind of obsessed with hockey, and that's the reason why his mom leaves. He wants his son to be a hockey player. Sandler's really into hockey. He's getting, and then they go to a game, and his father dies with a puck thrown at his head. He dies holding a video camera shooting the game.
Yes.
You have something to say?
Well, no? this errant video camera still annoys me because somebody's filming it the whole time. At one time, it happens to be the dad. Yeah. Who's the filmmaker? Who's the second shooter, Joe?
The second shooter, as because we already have Shooter McGavin. It can't be.
No. You've got the father shooting some of the footage, clearly. Yes. Who's shooting the rest of it? Who's the second one?
Wow, you really broke apart this movie already. I never thought about after his dad dies, who's shooting the rest of the movie.
Well, but he's not even in the first half, too. He's not shooting all of them, because some of them, the dad's in it.
Yeah.
The dad looking kind of Sandler-esque. Good casting.
Oh, of course. Yeah, great. Dennis Dugan really, really showing his chops already. As a young filmmaker. He doesn't look too young. I found out Dennis Dugan is in the movie. I think we talked about that earlier. You said, in the other one, you said he has like a Hitchcock thing he's trying to do where he shows up in all of his movies.
Well, I of course said that tongue in cheek, but yeah, who was he in this movie?
Sure, tongue in cheek. Yeah. Yes, where your tongue belongs. he is Doug, the tournament guy. He's the one that runs the
running the PTA tour. Oh, he looked kind of old. That's
yeah,
him?
I know.
Wow,
that's him.
All right,
that's Dennis Dugan.
Good for him having an aggressively boring role.
But where was it? Okay, so going back to his parents. So his dad dies at a hockey game. Wow. How did we not talk about it? So he's like, I'm gonna be super into hockey, but my dad died at a hockey game. More anger. That's why he's so angry. I was talking with our friend Rona. I was like, this movie should have been called Anger Management. Am I wrong? Am I wrong?
The
whole time, the plot of the movie is him managing his anger.
I mean, a little bit. They could have done a lot more with it. They chose not to.
They do a lot more in this movie, but anger management than they do in the movie Anger Management, which I think is a bad movie that we should never revisit.
Well, we have to watch it again for...
I know we have to.
For Jack Nicholson. Our first crossover episode.
Oh, God. It's going to be rough.
Yeah.
I watched that earlier this year. There's a lot that I did not remember that I somehow just, as a 25-year-old, was like, yeah, this is fine. Don't know why I ever thought that would have been okay. It's a really challenging movie.
Comedy can often be a product of its time. Well, the other issue with the father's hockey obsession is he clearly is a Terry O'Reilly fan, as Adam Sandler points out. But all the hockey gear we see them in is...
Boston Bruins.
No, it's the New York Islanders, Joe, where Terry O'Reilly was a very famous Bruins player. So there's like a schizophrenic hockey fandom going on in that household.
Oh, whoa.
I know.
I know that. I just know that Sandler's wearing that Boston Bruins jersey a lot.
Then why is the father a fan of the Islanders? Well, Adam Sandler, when he's growing up, is in Islanders uniforms.
Weird.
You get your shit together, movie.
And also, is there like some kind of like matte painting where at the golf course? Can you see that? It looks like a sheet that they're... It's not a projection, but it doesn't look like they're outside at some points. It looks like they're at a... You know what I'm talking about?
I will say, having seen this movie only 3 times in my life, I don't know.
You didn't notice.
That being said, that wouldn't surprise me.
Yeah, I mean, maybe a couple of like pickup shots where they're like, yeah, we need him to do this.
Yeah, really could be something like that. Anything that's not an aggressively wide shot. Just maybe they could have like a couple... Because we shot a film last fall where we needed a thing outdoors and we needed like a wide open field. The problem was when you're shooting in October, all the grass is dead from the hot, hot summers here in Southern California.
Oh, yeah.
So we're looking at a lot of golf courses where they have to be manicured, but people golf so early in the day, Joe. They're like, okay, you've got to be out of here by 5:30 in the morning. And I thought, okay, well, the sun's not even going to be out yet, so that won't help us. But there could be a thing where they were able to get an hour or two at the golf course early in the morning and then had to get the F out of there. So you get your pick, you know, your wide shots, your establishing stuff, and then you just do the rest in the studio. That's pretty easy to do.
And I think we were trying to figure out where this took place. I think you said New York last time.
I would say upstate New York, yes. Did you ever look it up?
No! I mean, how am I going to look it up? What would I look up? I don't know. Where was Happy Gilmore,
Where's the Happy Gilmore fan sites with all the fan theories like you just gave me?
What do you mean? Those are my theory. What are you talking about?
Yeah, you're everything a fan. I brought so this is your theory. I don't understand why this wouldn't count.
I don't know. I'll get to that in a minute. I got some more stuff I wanted to talk about, though. I got this here. Listen to this. Bob Barker wasn't sure if he wanted to be in the movie. When he learned that he was going to win the fight with Adam Sandler, he accepted the role. When Dennis Dugan told Bob Barker that a stunt double would be used in the fight scene, Barker insisted on doing his own stunt, saying, "Wait a minute, I know how to fight." It's a good line.
And it's fine, because, like, they're not doing anything other than kind of falling on the ground at one point. Like, their punches are noticeably not hitting each other, and which is, you know.
It's so
like, the movie also has, like, you know, Carl Weathers holding his own fake hand with it up in his sleeve, so the special effects were not the biggest concern for the movie, and it's fine when you're a silly comedy thing. No judgments there, but Bob Barker, you were going to be fine anyway. Just, you know, fall down one time.
In real life, Adam Sandler is terrible at both hockey and golf. It's just, when they go into the skating rink, him and Julie Bowen, who we will talk about in 1 minute. She calls him out. She's like, "And you're a hockey player?" Because he's so bad at skating. I'm going to say, I think the little thing where he's trying to be cutesy with her and, like, want to take her on a date. So he goes to the skating rink. And then the lights turn out, ooh, little mood setting. And then he plays Endless Love. This guy's a little softy. We didn't talk about how he's a little softy. He's a little romantic softy guy. I mean, he even talks about it. That's like, that's his grandmother's influence. Because his grandmother took him to see the movie when he was young. And he had a crush on Brooke Shields. Do you remember this whole thing?
Yeah. Yes, I just saw the movie, Joe.
Well, I don't know if you remember this specific moment.
I remember it all, Joe.
Wow. Okay. But yeah, that's just a nice, sweet little story. And I'm like, of course Virginia Bennett's going to fall for him when he tells this sweet story about his grandma. Of course. How can you not? She's like, I got to kiss this young stud.
Okay.
Do you know, you don't think that's a sweet moment?
I guess it's fine. I got no beef with it.
I like the moment more on this watch than when I watched it in June.
What makes it work is... Yeah, you know, she misses it and then does it anyway. So then it's like, okay, consensual.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah, definitely. That was the best part about it. Because she gets it in and he's
the
like...
The very best part. She did it willingly.
Yeah, no.
No one was forced to smooch Sandler against his will.
We always appreciate that. So, yeah, what I wanted to bring up from our previous record was that you had a real issue with Julie Bowen, who you kept calling Julia Bowen for a while. I don't know why.
I thought it was a different person.
But she looks the same.
She doesn't.
You really were hung up on that she, you're like, her cheeks, she's got big cheeks. And I'm like, she was a
They make her
a
eyes look
woman.
Different. Maybe she got work done. No judgments. I'm just, it's a theory.
I just think it's been 20 years and then she's...
It's one of our more famous bits from the early days of our podcast, and it has always stuck out to me. So when I was watching it this time, I was looking, I'm like, does it look like her now that I'm here trying to expect it? No. But it does sound like her quite a bit now that I'm paying attention. Still does not look like her.
Wow. Wow, still stuck in your ways.
That's still a job. Listen, I wish she looked like Hubie Halloween Julia Bowen. A much better character.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. This character, kind of boring mentor-ish love interest. That character?
Yeah.
Crazy lady. Oh,
she's
kind of
crazy, right?
The Firuza Balk of the Netflix Sandler era. Let's go. While we're talking about women, let's just... confirm the obvious that the movie does not pass the Bechdel test.
Of course not, unless you're considering, like, no, nothing.
No, it doesn't get close.
Maybe, no, because the only moment when there's not a man in a scene, it would be Julie Bowen talking to Frances Bay, the grandmother, and they're just talking about how they can make Happy feel better.
And he's, like, just elsewhere in the scene. He's just not in this little subgrouping.
He's putting.
Yeah, because the third, you know, the third act is this final golf tournament.
The other thing is, in that podcast, you kept wondering who the guy who says, Grizzly Adams did have a beard, and the guy just keeps showing up like when Chubbs Peterson dies out the window.
He's always just shaking his head.
Where did he show up from? Well, that guy is named Lee Trevino, and he is one of the all-time great golfers.
Oh, he's an actual golfer, all right?
He's an actual golfer.
So he probably wasn't the second shooter then.
The second shooter?
The second shooter of the prologue video.
Oh, no.
He just was always around, so it would make sense if he's just, like, in Sandler's life, just on the cusp.
I don't know how true this is. It says around 30 minutes of this film was cut in order to obtain the PG-13 rating. What?
What half hour of R-rated material did you have?
What would be R about this? This movie's pretty, like, sanitary.
The movie's 20 years old. There was never the two-hour version released. That seems unlikely.
It'd be cursing, right? There's nothing sexual in the movie. There's, like, no real violence. There's no drugs in it.
No, that's kind of the weirdness of Adam Sandler's kind of infantile comedy shtick is it puts women in, you know, lingerie, sure, but it's not overtly sexual in its nature. Mm-hmm. Like, it's too childlike to be that lascivious, you know? That'll be my review for Happy Gilmore. Not lascivious. Good watch.
Just Jesus Christ. Some of the people that were up for the role of Shooter McGavin.
Played by good wife alum.
Christopher McDonald. He's great.
He was a corrupt judge in The Good Wife.
Oh, God, that sounds perfect.
Oh, it was cool.
I might just watch that one episode.
I think he's in a couple. Like, it's a little arc thing that he has. It's been a while. The Good Fight coming to its last season. It's very sad. There's like 4 episodes left. It's been off the hook this season, Joe. They don't give a shit this year. Alan Cumming should win an Emmy. It's great.
Oh, great. Good for him. I hope he does. He deserves it. He does a lot of Disney voices.
Oh, he does? Really?
Yeah, like voices that you would never have imagined either.
I want better for him. I'll cast you, Alan Cumming.
You know what?
What?
We've done an Alan Cumming movie before.
Which one?
Moana.
He was in Moana?
He's the voice of the chicken.
No, he's not, is he?
Yes, he is.
Alan Cumming?
Is the voice of the chicken. He looks so upset.
He can do better.
Well, he got paid probably a very
nice
sum.
I'm not saying he shouldn't take the job. I just wish he'd get cast
more. He took the job so he could be paid probably, maybe they get some good CBS money from that. Paramount Network.
Yeah, it's fine. But go on.
Bruce Campbell was who auditioned for the role of Shooter McGavin. What do you think of that?
A little too goofy.
Yeah.
He's a little too close to Adam Sandler's type.
He's not menacing. I feel like Christopher McDonald's very menacing.
He could do like the upper, I don't know, like Kyle MacLachlan, they can do this like upper class, super bougie thing, but I don't think he can do like the asshole thing very well.
Oh, MacLachlan would have been in a weird period of his life in this movie.
Yeah.
Post-Twin Peaks. Oh, man. That's crazy.
Adam Sandler being like, hey, man, I liked you in that Twin Peaks show. I don't quite know what was going on, but I thought it was cool.
I like it.
Yeah.
Bruce Campbell. And then Steve Guttenberg was briefly considered for the role.
Wow. The Goot.
Yeah, but he was doing the Olsen Twins movie It Takes Two with Kirstie Alley.
Oh, yeah, that's where you wanted to saddle yourself, did you?
I mean,
he says, I don't know about this Happy Gilmore thing, but It Takes Two.
I think that movie might have made more money than this. He might have chose the better option for himself.
So Steve Guttenberg in a movie with both Ted Danson and Kirstie Alley. Look at that. Good for him.
An 8% on... No, it didn't make much money.
It's crazy that Kirstie Alley got feature roles from Cheers because Cheers did not utilize her properly too much.
Yeah, I mean, I still gotta get into Cheers. It's one that's been on the list for a while.
Cheers still holds up 40 years later. Still good.
Yeah, obviously. The cast.
Some good shows don't know. They don't hold up very well. I don't think the cast of Friends is bad. That show doesn't hold up.
I haven't revisited it in about 10 years.
Yeah, that show is so dated, style-wise and humor-wise, and it just, I don't know, like I hear college-age kids, they still find it on Netflix and they like it, but I can't go back. I don't recommend anyone going back. Cheers. 40 years old.
40 years
old. Like, it's crazy that show's still relevant, but it is.
Yeah.
All right. No, that's,
well,
everybody
like
knows
Friends
I love
is about upper class, like upper class people in living in New York in these giant apartments.
It is kind of crazy how
Cheers is about a bunch of people like hanging out in a bar.
Well, like I don't like the humor doesn't like the characters. I don't think are as interesting as the ones in Cheers.
Mm-hmm.
And Comedy Today is going to have a tough time because it's all so self-referential. The vast majority of Cheers is just wacky characters bouncing off each other. Like, it does the old-timey sitcom premise very well. Taxi, still good. That show's even older. Mm.
That is much older.
Yeah, that show's 45 years old. Still hilarious.
During the mini-golf scene, Adam Sandler provided the voice of the laughing clown. And now that is playing back in my head, and that sounds like Sandler. I'm going to think of that every time now. Oh yeah, and then when they're doing the golf game with the celebrities from the game shows or whatever, or just like TV personalities,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
On the board, did you see a name? I this is just my conspiracy part coming back.
Well, I was paying attention to the names to see if there were like any in jokes in there, but it seemed like the vast majority of the names were like generic enough where they didn't have to worry about. I mean, rights issues or whatever, or indemnification.
Well, you haven't brought it up yet for this episode, so why will? There was a name called Frasier.
Hey, baby, I hear the blues are calling, tossed salads and scrambled eggs.
I didn't see that at all.
There was a Frasier name. It's like said Frasier Robinson, and I'm like,
Yes.
Was our guy there?
Well, you know, that would have been Crane Robinson, of course.
Oh, you're right. You're right.
When failed wrong, again, wrong. Joe.
Richard Keel.
That's right, the return.
Plays Mr. Larson, his old boss, who he shoots in the head with a nail gun.
From a rebel rouser actor.
He has a orange shirt at the end of this movie that says, "Guns don't kill people. I kill people."
Yeah.
That's a good joke. he's a large man. And James Bond, as Jaws, he did kill people.
Maybe that's what they were referencing.
I hope so.
Yeah.
You gotta imagine Sandler was like, yeah, James Bond, Richard Keel. What else would he know him from?
Rebel Rousers, obviously.
Yes.
He's like, hey, you were in that sweet Jack Nicholson biker film. Keel's like, well, I don't know if I'd say sweet, but I was in it, and it was a film.
Yeah, so his second most famous role would be Happy Gilmore. Think he's done too much. Pale Rider? He was in Pale Rider.
Yeah, I don't know what that is.
You don't know Pale Rider? It's a Clint Eastwood movie.
Oh, okay.
It's
you
like
know
a
what?
Western.
I do know what that is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm so sure you knew what that was.
It's coming back.
That's like, besides Happy Gilmore and James Bond.
And Rebel Rousers.
And the Rebel Rousers. He's great, though.
Well, you know, that's the problem when you have a very specific look. There's only so many roles for you.
Yeah, but you would think that he would just show up as like a villain in other movies or like something, or like a heavy.
A heavy, yeah.
He's just got a presence. I liked him a lot.
Could have had Steve Austin's role in The Expendables.
I think he died before that. I think he died in 2004.
Well, that's why he wasn't in it.
Yeah, because he was dead.
But he would have been if the opportunity were there.
He's got all of his like SNL friends in this. Which is nice.
In the whole Adam Sandler stable, Kevin Nealon certainly is the one that looks most like a golfer.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. I'm trying to think.
Did you see Will Sasso early in this film?
Oh, hell yeah.
Former Rock, what was that movie?
He's in Southland Tales.
Southland
Tales,
yeah. Former Southland Tales alum, Will Sasso, looking very fat in this movie. I'm very happy he's lost.
He's a large man.
Yeah, but no, he's like unhealthy fat in here. I'm very happy he has lost the weight since then.
He's got a belly.
And he's certainly, he is a big dude now, but at least it looks like reasonable.
It's funny you brought up Steve Austin and the Expendables, because Will Sasso, on an episode of WWF at that time, SmackDown, came out as Stone Cold Steve Austin.
Like a gay Stone Cold Steve Austin?
Why would he be gay?
You said he came out as Stone Cold Steve Austin.
Oh, Jesus Christ. You read way too much into that. No, he came out of the entrance ramp, and he came down. He was all dressed like Stone Cold Steve Austin.
Steve Austin, and then the real Steve Austin was like, "I don't think so, brother." I guess that's
yeah, and he
wrestling.
Beat the shit out of him.
Yeah,
but it was funny because he put the ball cap on. He had the big shirt.
Will Sasso needed a ball cap. He had hair at the time. I've only known him bald.
Yeah, he's got a little bit of hair.
All right.
Yeah, he's got hair in this movie.
Yeah, you know he did. That's true.
he's got a little crew cut.
Well, I say, I like
this
movie.
Yeah, what are you
going to
say about this?
I like this movie more this time, crazy enough.
Hell yeah.
I still find the beginning very boring. This whole, you know, this big, you know, whatever, background info I need that I don't need. The girlfriend breaking up with him thing doesn't seem to matter. I guess they get a joke or two out of it, but...
It's one of the best ongoing jokes when he keeps saying, oh, my girlfriend fell off a cliff and died on impact.
Well, even in the moment, I like sort of everybody just kind of listening in to him over the speaker. And then the Asian lady shows
it gives
up.
You so much.
And then in the morning, she's still in the apartment. Like,
yeah.
Some of the way the jokes are... the jokes overall, I like. I like the jokes way more than I like the story, which has Barry Lyndon effect, where it's like too perfectly plotted. It's a script I recommend.
Hold on. Yeah. This needs to go down in the history of this podcast that you compared Happy Gilmore to a recent new favorite of mine, Barry Lyndon, the Stanley Kubrick film. Oh, man. Fantastic. Go on.
Yes. Okay. So for some background on this, before I go on to my main point. Yeah. Barry Lyndon, Kubrick felt, was like his best film. A lot of film critics call it a perfect film. And I postulate that's why I think most people find it boring. Because it's too good. There's not a little rough edge or something to hold on to. So this script... too good. It hits all the points so well at the time that it should. The suspense and the mystery is gone because you just instinctually know what's going to happen and then it does and it doesn't feel satisfying because it could only be this way. The good news is the jokes are interesting enough to keep you going.
Mm-hmm.
The other good news is, like I was saying, young screenwriters should study this script because it does do all the things Hollywood scripts should be doing. And if you want your scripts to be marketable, this is a good way to do it.
You hear that? In 1996, Adam Sandler and Robert Smigel, I think they got... No, it was Tim Hurley. He wrote this one with Sandler. Should have been the winners of the Best Original Screenplay Oscar. Do you hear that, folks? We are recommending that they take back, pause while I look up the winners of the 1996 Oscar.
No, I don't, this is, now you're reading too much into something. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying if you need a template, Happy Gilmore is not a bad one to start with. I could see how this film got made. It's this fish out of water, marketable comedy thing. You have built in product placement just in the nature of your film. Subway comes up and it feels germane all the time. And that gets you some extra money too. The jokes are working. His character in this one's more consistent than it is in Billy Madison. And interestingly enough, both Billy Madison and Happy Gilmore have set the final third act stakes with a handshake agreement that likely wouldn't hold up in any court of any kind.
Absolutely. But I'm telling you, we need to take away Ethan Coen and Joel Coen's script for Fargo.
Oh, my God. Tim Hurley, he's at home watching the Oscars and he goes, damn, we got robbed.
They did get robbed. Fargo, what is this?
Fargo,
trash?
What? Typical Academy move. You had brought up last time we did this, the grandmother's tax information.
Oh, God, yes.
Your math was off a bit.
Yeah, was it 5 or 10 years? You kept telling me 10 years.
It
and
was,
I was like,
10 years,
five.
And so I did the math, and it just meant she didn't pay $27,000 a year in taxes. Should there have been no interest on what she owed them?
I was so hung up about that.
I know.
I apologize.
But speaking of Adam Sandler and the Asian lady, it's nice of Sandler to be ahead of its time by normalizing interracial relationships.
Don't know how much of a relationship that was. It looked like a one-night stand.
All right. Well, normalizing interracial sexual relationships.
Okay, there we go.
Yeah. And the movie also was ahead of its time in prognosticating the sensationalization of the spectacle of the game over the fundamentals of the game. Now, you know, football has decided it wants to subtly encourage offense more with the new rules that it makes to help with fantasy football, and things look splashier. Around this time, two baseball players are hitting more home runs than ever and doing steroids to do it, and the MLB allegedly is sort of like keeping that on the hush-hush because ratings are up. So cool.
This isn't a shit. Go back to your shanties. What is a shanty? Do you know what a shanty is?
Yeah, it's like a
when
little.
He says that, I'm like, what?
A little shitty house shack thing.
Oh, okay.
Like a Hooverville, a shanty town.
This is golf.
Yeah, you know, so I kind of feel bad for Shooter McGavin.
Wow, sympathy for Shooter.
A little bit, because, you know, he's got a point where he's like, I've been working on this for like 35 years, and you just come here and in 4 months I can't best you? I'd be pissed too.
Wait, how old do you think Shooter McGavin is?
I bet he's like 40-something, 42 or whatever.
Okay.
Well, Tiger Woods starts when he's like 5. Shooter's probably starting early.
Yeah, I'm going to get the age of Chris McDonald, 55. So he is considerably older than Sandler. He was 41. Wow, you are almost right on the money.
Yeah, see? Well, I don't know. Shooter McGavin's working all the hard and tough and pay, like he does, you know, paying his dues and doing all the crap and winning all the tournaments on the tour, except this one, apparently, that mattered.
Oh, yeah, the one with the, he gets all these big checks and Sandler's just like, well, he's got big checks. Why can't I? And he's getting like checks for like $4,200 and coming like 41st place.
I, as a filmmaker who's worked really hard for 17 years now to get where I am just now, if somebody, you know, just said, hey, I'm going to make a movie and then next year they win an Oscar, I'm going to be pissed. That's going to suck.
You hear that, Damien Chazelle? Scale's coming for you.
Other than that, Shooter McGavin's an asshole, but, you know, on a fundamental level, I kind of feel for his pain. But and the script is smart in, like, lampooning this super serious, self-important golf thing and putting a blue-collar guy in there. Like, Julie Bowen's character has a point where they're like, golf has a relatable figure now. Like, yeah.
Yeah.
That's why this, as a comedy movie itself, would do well. Adam Sandler's clothing style, cemented very early on. Adam Sandler's life in general,
giant
his clothing
jerseys.
Style, he didn't try to be somebody else and then said, nah, I'd rather be comfortable. He just said, yeah, I'm doing me. Deal with it.
He really, really cements it in Big Daddy, though. That's where I feel like it's just, I'm not even going to, like, because at some points on the tour, he's wearing collared shirts. He's got like this red and white striped one he's wearing.
I guess I thought that was like a flannel-y thing, so it kind of worked anyway.
Yeah, I think it's one time he wears a nice shirt.
All right. I don't remember. That didn't stand out. I just remember seeing aggressively baggy jeans.
Yes, definitely.
And some boots on the golf course.
Yeah, the real big boots, unlaced or not tied up.
Anyway, going back to my earlier point with Shooter and sort of the script working in general, as a villain, the thing that script-wise works about him is he becomes the thing he despises most in the last act. He becomes a spectacle distracting from the game of golf when he's doing all the Happy Gilmore antics too when he's angry and pissed off. He's swinging his club, he's throwing it, he's cursing on TV.
And Sandler has his arc because he says, I'm kind of enjoying this now.
Yeah, he accepts that he's a golfer.
He
stops trying to be the hockey player. He finds his happy place, so he finally overcomes his anger.
He's got his nice golf ball whacker guy.
Yeah, he's
thing.
Got the hockey stick thing, so he's kind of, you know, because that passion is in there, as Chubb says. Chubbs and the alligator become friends in heaven. Like, all the things are tied with a little bow.
With Abraham Lincoln.
Yeah, Alan Covert got to sneak in a line there at the end.
What did he say? I didn't hear it. I looked for it again this time. What did he say?
Adam Sandler says something like, get out or you're welcome too. And the guy's like, okay. And steps out of the car.
There we go.
Or like, yes, sir, or something like that. It was something along those lines. Going back to the directing, the jokes are directed well and things like that. There's a lot of good visual gags and the camera revealing. But then some of the more verbal jokes and some of the just conversational scenes in general are a little clumsy or feel lazy. Like this is what I was complaining about with Mark Felt, where very aggressively people have to reposition themselves to get this shot reverse shot thing to make sense. Just let them kind of go back and forth here and then leave. Like, I don't have to do this weird abrupt stopping and turning around and inhuman kind of blocking. You don't need to do that, Dennis Dugan, but whatever. His movie made a bunch of money, so he's fine. He's learned nothing from the mistakes of this movie. And I have not seen such aggressive Subway product placement since Hawaii Five-0, but at least here they make it work as a joke and it's somewhat germane.
Talk about a hole in one.
It's sort of calling itself out for the Subway product placement.
So, Dennis Dugan, before this, he directs, I'll give you some of his directing credits.
Yeah.
Two episodes of the TV series Hunter. Ever heard of it?
Nope.
One episode of the TV series Wise Guy.
Nope. Nope.
Five episodes of the TV series Moonlighting.
Oh, well, that one I've heard of.
There we go. His first feature, Problem Child.
No.
You never heard of Problem Child?
No.
It's got, what's his face? John Ritter.
Yeah? I've not heard of this. No?
Brain Donors. Never heard of this?
No.
Jesus Christ, what is this? John Turturro! I was not expecting that. That's something I will be checking out now. Brain Donors, okay. He did two episodes of the series Civil War. Okay, one episode of Doogie Howser.
I know that one.
One episode of Columbo.
Ah, I know that one.
The funny thing is, do you think the one episode of Columbo he directed is the episode that they are watching in Big Daddy?
Did he direct Big Daddy?
Yeah, he directed Big Daddy. He's in Big Daddy, remember? He goes to their house. Sandler and the kid go to their
house.
Joe,
I don't remember him being in Big Daddy, a movie I saw in 2015.
It's kind of a big scene in Big Daddy.
I don't remember that he would have been Dennis Dugan. I didn't know what he looked like, and I didn't care enough.
In Big Daddy, he goes, Sandler and the kid go to this guy's house. And the guy at the house does not want to give candy for Halloween to the little kid. So Sandler somehow enters this guy's house from behind him, pushes him to the door and says, give him things. And he has to give him his watch off his wrist. He has to give him like CDs.
Oh, yeah, I remember that scene. It's coming
back.
It's
during the garbage montage.
I don't know what that guy looks like, but I remember that scene.
He looks like Doug from this movie. He's like 3 years older. What is your face right now? I'm going to take a picture of that face.
No pictures. I tire of you and your nonsense.
He doesn't really direct anything more like of note after Columbo until Happy Gilmore.
Yeah, good thing he and Sandler found each other.
Yeah, and then he directs Beverly Hills Ninja. Yep, the last Farley solo vehicle. And yeah, then Big Daddy, and he directs a bunch of Sandler movies after that, and that's fun. Doesn't really work with Sandler anymore.
So as we wind down this conversation...
I want to round down this conversation.
No.
Though.
What are we... How do we look back at these last 7-8 years, and how do we think it's affected our current view of Happy Gilmore?
I'm watching it as a father now, and I'm going to say... I hope I don't take my son to a hockey game and die with a puck to the head, because I don't want my kid having that much anger issues. He looks like he had a hard life. Just, you know, I don't want to drive the mom away. You know, I don't want to drive Tanya away.
No, you don't want her to move to Egypt.
Yeah,
because she likes movies too much, and there's no movies in Egypt.
I would fear about wrestling more than movies.
Oh yeah, there's probably no wrestling over there either.
Maybe. Who knows?
Maybe like some old-fashioned Greco-Roman wrestling still. A little Ptolemaic wrestling going on over there.
What do you got for me?
I was surprised. I didn't mind the movie this much and enjoyed the humor more. I think maybe some of that is Sandler Stockholm Syndrome, having me not go in there being grumpy. My takes, you know, I still think the script is... It's too boring in how well it's written, but I seem less incensed about that. And I'm just like, yeah, you know, the formula works. It kind of sucks, but it does. So there's that too. I appreciated the jokes a lot more. I still think Julia Bowen looks different.
Julie Bowen.
But I think overall, I don't know. I've, you know, I know what I like because I'm so grounded in that. what I do and what I like, that I can look at the other things that I don't do and or like and be more objective about them, which allows me to appreciate the things they do do well. I think that edge of me is gone. All right, well, let's thank Lev for doing this one again for us and finding some of those old files for us to work into this episode. I'd like to thank Joe Vekeman for stopping by and watching a movie he watches on his own anyway.
I love this movie.
And I am your host, Patrick Scaly. You may find my features, documentaries, short films, video essays, animations, behind-the-scenes footage, and so much more at QuixoticUnited.com and social media, presumably with a similar-sounding name. Thank you all for listening. Joe, say goodnight.
Good night. I was hoping you couldn't hear my stomach growling constantly, saying, "Feed me, feed me." I have not eaten since, like, I don't know, 10:30 last night.
But they don't let you have lunch at work?
I didn't have lunch, and I didn't feel like spending money on lunch, so I just ate something before I came in. So it's fine. No big deal. I'll eat when we're done. It's not like we're going to be, like, 5 hours. My body can hold off.
All right, so what was it? You did the thing. What were you talking about, homework? You listened to the episode again?
Oh, yeah, listen to the episode. I got lots of stuff to talk about with that episode. In fact. I got a couple of things I want to call you out. I'm sure you're going to call me out on a couple
of things. Wow, you're going to call me out?
Yeah. Wow. Yeah, yeah. I got it's like one thing. It's just you keep bringing it up, and I'm like, what are you talking about?
Okay.
It's fun.
I have a thought on what it might be, but we'll see.
You definitely know what it is. Okay. The one thing you don't stop talking about.
Well, all right, then we can.
Yeah, now you're curious. I finally have peaked. No,
I feel like I wanted to complain about something, but I don't know what it is. Nah, I guess I won't. I really feel like I'm mad about something this week.
That's fine. You can be mad.
But I don't know what it is.
Well, we will be mad Friday.
Well, Thursday.
Well, we're recording Friday morning, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But the real anger will be when I'm sitting in a chair.
Are you going to an AMC?
Yeah, I'm not paying for this.
Yes. You still see the Nicole Kidman ad?
Yeah, probably.
I'd like to see it one more time before it goes away. It's supposed to be going away at the end of the year, I thought. But they might have continued it. I don't know. She might have come back in and said, hey, I got to
They said, we
got to
redo this again and get Black Adam involved in this montage of great cinema. Is she in a Marvel movie?
No, she's in a DC movie. She's in the universe with The Rock.
What movie's she in?
Oh, God. Do you want to guess what movie she's in? So there's Superman.
Yeah.
Batman.
Uh-huh.
Aquaman.
Yeah.
Wonder Woman.
Yeah.
And The Flash. Which one do you think she's in? The Flash movie hasn't come out yet, but there is a cast and there's a movie that's been made.
I don't know. Is she Lois Lane? Am I remembering that right?
No, that's Amy Adams. Yeah. No, she's Aquaman's mom.
I'm sure that's an extremely juicy role.
It's not. It's
I'm shocked. That's what you do with Nicole Kidman. I guess, you know, she's like, all right, I'll take the money. I saw what Anthony Hopkins did. No, I'll do that.
The Aquaman movie, like, quietly rules. It snuck over the $1 billion line somehow. It made more than the Justice League movie. Isn't that crazy?
That is crazy.
Because I don't think anybody was really anticipating Aquaman at the end of 2018 in December, but that movie made so much money. It's fun. It's just a lot of fun. I don't think it's a good movie, but it's a lot of fun. Willem Dafoe plays his, like, mentor teacher, and he's just...
Oh, the Northman.
Yeah, and he's in real Northman-like looking, because he's like, yeah, it's great. He looks like the character from the Northman. It's so fun.
I don't want to talk about superheroes anymore. I want to talk about
golf.
Yeah,
we have to do that all day to Friday.
Yeah, a legitimate 47 and a half hours from now.
We'll be podcasting.
We will be doing this again.
That's fun, though. I like
Yeah, we have fun, but not with The Rock.